Welcome to the fourth review of Space and Astronomy News, selected for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel. The news, which will be weekly, will try to provide a quick overview of everything interesting that has happened in recent days in the field of astronomical research and space exploration. Don't forget to keep following us. Astronews, recent space news, discoveries, April 2021. Number 1. Have you ever thought of this? According to a new study, raindrops from other solar system worlds would be strikingly similar in size and shape to Earth's rain, despite very different chemical compositions and environmental situations. Rainfall is widespread throughout the solar system, more so than is commonly believed. Obviously, it rains water on Earth, but it rains sulfuric acid on Venus. It snows carbon dioxide on Mars. It rains helium and grains of ammonia on Jupiter. It rains methane on Titan, and potentially it could rain diamonds on Neptune. It could even rain iron or quartz on some planets if the conditions were right. However, what falls from the sky is varied. It seems that all the raindrops that form rain on other worlds are roughly the same size, regardless of anything else. On any planet where there's a cycle of evaporation and condensation of a gas, such as water on Earth, rain is the key element in bringing what is in the atmosphere back to the surface. Because raindrops fall in places far from where they formed, they are able to transport heat from one part of the atmosphere to another. Therefore, precipitations have an essential role in the climatic equilibrium, and knowing their properties allows us to have a deeper picture of the cycles that govern a planetary atmosphere. Nevertheless, studying them remains a challenge for climatological models because of the extreme complexity of atmospheric systems governed by many different and chaotic variables and laws. In a recent study conducted at Harvard University, researchers delved into some aspects of planetary precipitation. The result is that raindrops are extremely similar in size in the various planets, even between worlds that could not be more different, as in the case of Earth and Jupiter. Researchers then focused on just one aspect of these complex phenomena, the behavior of individual drops. An essential aspect to study is the size. If the drop is too small, it evaporates before touching the surface. On the other hand, if it is too large, it breaks because the surface tension cannot keep it. And this applies whether we talk about water, methane, or liquid iron in an exoplanet like WASP 76b. In short, there would be an optimal size range in which the drops are neither too large nor too small. And the researchers identified it from studying the shape of the drop, the speed of the fall, and the speed of evaporation. The shape is the same for different materials and depends only on their mass. When it is small, it is spherical, and as it gets larger, it acquires an increasingly elongated shape. The speed of fall depends strongly on this shape, the force of gravity, and the density of air. Evaporation is faster or slower depending on local atmospheric properties as a whole, such as composition, pressure, temperature, and humidity. The finding of the Harvard research is that despite the wide variety of conditions that can be present in different planetary atmospheres, the optimal droplet size lies in a narrow range. This has important consequences for the study of planetary atmospheres and their habitability, but also for the modeling of Earth's climatology. Number 2. And still speaking of meteorology, for a few days the net had fun commenting on a photo taken by Perseverance, the rover that for more than a month had been wandering among the Martian sands of Jezero crater. A rainbow on Mars? Possible? The phenomenon would have been captured last April 4th. Too bad, however, that the multicolored arc is not a real natural rainbow, but the effect of something else. But why can't it be a rainbow? The reason is simple. For a rainbow to form, there must be water droplets in the air and the sun near the horizon. When both these conditions are met, looking in the direction opposite to the sun, you can see a beautiful colored arc. It is what sometimes happens on Earth after a thunderstorm, but on Mars, the water droplets are not formed. It is too cold and at most create very small ice crystals, and moreover, at that time, the sun was too high on the horizon. But if it's not a rainbow, then what did Perseverance photograph? Some have suggested that the phenomenon of light refraction was produced by tiny specks of dust that would produce the same effect. But this is not the explanation either. It is more technical and has nothing natural about it. It is almost certainly a trivial reflection of the camera lens that took the images. In reality, at the moment of the shot, the camera was pointing south. in the direction of the sun, and the light produced that artifact by crossing the lens of the camera, as can also happen on Earth. Number 3. For Mars, we now take a quick jump to get 2,000 light years further, where with new processing techniques, NASA's Hubble Space Telescope has captured the beautiful Veil Nebula in the finest detail ever. The new image, released by NASA on April 2nd, was captured using new processing techniques that highlight small details like the nebula's delicate thread and filaments of ionized gas. Observations were taken by Hubble's Wide Field Camera 3 using 5 different filters. New post-processing methods were used to further enhance emissions from doubly ionized oxygen, seen in the image in blue, ionized hydrogen, and ionized nitrogen, seen in red. This is not the first time the Veil Nebula has been featured in a Hubble image release. The space telescope captured a less detailed but still beautiful image of the nebula in 2017. The Veil Nebula exists about 2,100 light-years from Earth in the constellation of Cygnus. It's part of the nearby Cygnus Loop, which is a remnant of a supernova created about 10,000 years ago by the death of a star 20 times the mass of our Sun. The cataclysmic release of energy following the star's death resulted in the Veil Nebula's delicate filaments of ionized gas. Okay guys, hang on a second before we continue. Don't forget to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Number 4. What was that story about the killer always returning to the scene of the crime? On April 7th, NASA's Osiris-Rex probe had a final close encounter with the asteroid Bennu. During the flyover, the probe photographed the small 500-meter diameter asteroid from a distance of 3.7 kilometers. The Osiris-Rex team decided to add this last flyover before saying goodbye to the asteroid, after they realized that the surface of Osiris-Rex was significantly disturbed by the October 20th, 2020 sample collection event. During the landing, the spacecraft's sampling head actually penetrated half a meter into the ground and simultaneously fired a pressure charge of nitrogen gas. The probe's thrusters also moved a significant amount of surface material during the return phase. Because Bennu's gravity is very weak, the various forces that acted on that occasion had dramatic repercussions on the site, lifting and flinging away many of the rocks in the region, as well as a lot of dust. This final flyover of Bennu will provide the team with an opportunity to understand how the spacecraft's contact with Bennu's surface altered the sample site and the surrounding region. After the Bennu flyover, it will take several days for the data to be transferred to Earth. Once it arrives, the team will inspect the images, comparing them to those taken in 2019 during the probe's arrival to understand how Osiris-Rex disturbed the asteroid's surface material and how, if at all, the dust affected the performance of the scientific instruments. This data is definitely useful to start the discussion of mining of asteroids. The spacecraft will remain in the vicinity of Bennu until May the 10th, when the mission will enter the phase called Return Cruise and begin its 2-year journey to Earth. As it approaches Earth, the probe will launch the sample return capsule, which contains rocks and dust collected on Bennu. The capsule will then travel through Earth's atmosphere and land by parachute at the Utah Test and Training Range on September 24, 2023. Once recovered, it will be transported to the agency's Johnson Space Center in Houston, where the sample will be removed and then distributed to laboratories around the world. Number 5. If you're wondering what happened to Ingenuity, the small Perseverance helicopter that was supposed to take off on April 8th, don't worry. There was only one small problem. Let's see what and how NASA is trying to fix it. A few days after making it through the freezing night of April 3rd to 4th in a high-speed rotor spin-up test performed on April 9th, the control system shut down the rotor. Over the weekend, the team considered and tested several possible solutions, coming to the conclusion that the best thing to do was to reinstall the flight control software, which was done on April 12th and 13th. Although the software modification is simple, the process of validation and completion of the connection to Ingenuity will take time, because to get to the helicopter, the path is not direct, having to first pass by the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter and Perseverance. As of today, the date for the new high-speed spin-up test and the first flight of Ingenuity is not yet known, but already next week there could be news. Anyway guys, don't worry, Ingenuity is working fine. Its critical functions such as power, communications, and thermal control are stable. It's not at all strange that a prototype like this has issues that need to be addressed and resolved in real time. That's its job, to let us find out what can go wrong, figure out how to troubleshoot, and fix it. In the meantime, while the Ingenuity team is moving forward with the software upgrade, Perseverance is getting ready to test another technology demonstrator, MOXIE, Mars Oxygen ISRU experiment, which will be used to test oxygen production on Mars for future human missions. Number 6. And from Mars, back to Earth. We know very well that our planet, during its annual tour around the Sun, crosses swarms of debris scattered by comets and asteroids, because we often notice and wonder about it while observing shooting stars. What we may not imagine is that although the typical size of a shooting star is a few millimeters and its weight does not exceed 1 gram, our planet collects every year about 5,200 tons of this cosmic debris. This number, impressive to think of it in absolute terms, is the result of a 20-year sampling carried out near the Franco-Italian base Concordia in Antarctica. Located 1,100 kilometers inside the Antarctic Plateau and at 3,200 meters above sea level, this inhospitable place offers, in fact, unique conservation conditions for micrometeorites against aqueous alteration and anthropic and terrestrial contamination. In order to avoid contamination due to base activities, snow samples were extracted from channels with depths greater than 2 meters, in correspondence of the snow fallen in the years preceding 1995, the year of the beginning of human activities in the area. More precisely, the fall period of the collected particles was from 1920 to 1980. The snow was melted and the water filtered to extract solids down to a size of about 30 microns, 0.03 millimeters, a little smaller than the width of a human hair. The micrometeorites they found are in two broad classes, unmelted meteorites and cosmic spherules. The former are irregular-shaped bits which survive the atmospheric entry unaltered, while the spherules are from bits that were heated by their hypersonic passage through our air and formed teeny little balls. In total, scientists found 1,280 unmelted micrometeorites and 808 cosmic spherules, ranging in size from 30 to 350 microns. Measuring the masses and sizes and using the dates and amounts of snow they were found in, they find that the rate at which these things fall to the ground is about 3 and 5.6 micrograms per square meter per year, so not much. But when you multiply by the very large area of the Earth and extrapolating to a slightly higher size range of 12 to 700 microns, they get their number of 5,200 tons per year or 14 tons per day. But wait a minute, although 14 tons may seem like a frighteningly large amount, other studies have always talked about at least 100 tons a day. Is one of these wrong? No, actually, they're compatible. Most of the material that enters our atmosphere is small, smaller than a grain of sand. A lot of that material ablates off the meteoroid, heats up, and is blown off by the rapid passage through air, creating smoke particles that are even smaller than 30 microns. This material tends to stay in the upper atmosphere, creating a layer of meteoroid dust 90 to 100 kilometers above the ground. Even if it falls to the ground, it wouldn't have been counted in this survey because the particles are too small. So the total amount of material hitting us per year is much higher. Interestingly, on average, the amount of larger meteoritic material, what you normally think of as meteorites, that hits us is much lower, only about 10 tons per year. Bigger stuff is much more rare. The scientists were also able to get an idea of where this material came from by looking at its composition, and they find that about 80% of it comes from comets and the rest from asteroids. That jives decently with what we know of dust in the inner solar system, though some questions do remain. So that's all for this week. What do you think? What news struck you the most?